Hello, my name is Michael Evans, and this is Cards and Boards. Going to be unboxing my Cards and Boards subscription of the month, which I got from the offline board game cafe. I got it last night. We were out doing Breakout St. John, which is right next to the board game cafe. Went in. As soon as I walked in, pointed at me and goes, grabbed something from the counter, hands it to me. I love it when that happens. It's great. You know, people know me well enough that, you know, I got your package in. It was a couple days early, so. Hello, it's a Cards and Boards subscription. I already know what game it is because the wrapping is transparent, but it's wrapped so nicely. I kind of feel bad about ripping the paper. This month is Dead of Winter, a Crossroads game. Now, a friend of mine owns this. I've played it a few times. A really fun game. Basically, you're a survivor. You're part of a surviving colony in the post-apocalyptic world. You're foraging for food. You're trying to keep your colony alive. Most of you are, at least. There's a chance it's going to be, one of you is going to be a traitor. So, to make matters worse, everyone has their own special goal. So, whether you're loyal or a traitor, you can be doing things that make it look like you're not so loyal, you might be the traitor. So, there might be no traitor, but everyone's acting suspiciously, so it's hard to tell what's going on. And then, to make matters even worse, there's also zombies around, trying to kill you. I think that's one of the few things about this game that throw me off, is the fact that the zombies have to go, oh yeah, and there's zombies. It's the same problem I have with The Walking Dead. When the zombies are no longer of real importance, they're just sort of background, they're just off in the background, they're like, oh, yeah, there's a tree, and look at a bush, and look at rock, and look at another zombie. You know, it's... I don't care for that sort of mentality. I figure if there's a zombie apocalypse, that should be the main focus. Unless you've gotten yourself built up so protected that either the zombies are gone, or there's no way the zombies can get you. And they don't. But like I say, it's... That's just me, though, I think. I prefer the zombies to be the main focus of zombie things. So what do you get in Dead of Winter? Now, that doesn't take anything away from this game. This game is still a really good game. A lot of dice. You get a lot of dice. Baggies, a lot of standees. This is your threat dice. Whenever you're moving or moving from one place to another, you roll this dice and see how you're going to die. These are location cards. Basically, you set it up so you'll have the you'll have a main compound, which I'll show you in a moment, and it has these location cards. Now, the location cards, they have a spot here. That's where the deck goes. Each location has a deck where you can of things you can find in that location. They have spots where the people can go, and down here, spots where the zombies can go. If there are people here, it'll track zombies. Once this is full, they'll start killing the zombies, start killing the people off. And you can make, if you're looking for stuff, you draw a card. If you don't like what you draw, you can make noise and keep drawing cards until you find one you like. Keep that one, discard the rest. The more noise you have, the more likely there are more zombies will come. So that's a very dangerous thing to do. They have player aid cards. They have five of them. They have five player aids. Of course, the rule book. The rule book isn't that bad. Seen better, seen worse. I've definitely seen worse from Plat Hat Games. Mice and Mystic being the worst rulebook I've ever seen. But like I say, that's actually a pretty good rulebook. You have tokens. You have barricade. You have... I can't remember what they're called. The unimportant survivors, basically. The ones who don't do anything for you. They just eat your food. The freeloading survivors. Extra zombie tokens in case you run out of zombie standees. These are the tokens to show for the noise on the location cards. You have food tokens. One counts rounds, one counts morality. You have character standees. You have damage. This is damage. This is frostbite. Frostbite is worse than damage because if you have frostbite, then you keep getting damage each turn afterwards and keep getting damage. And until basically it will kill you. You have the zombie standees, some more zombie tokens. And you have the empty food container, or the starvation counters. Those are bad. Basically, if you can't feed your people, you get those, and they start eating away at your morality and at your morale. They eat away at your morale. This is your the base your compound that you're in. Each spot here is where the zombies go. This is where your characters start out. It's also where the useless survivors are. I can't remember what they're called off the top of my head. Place you can put the food tokens when you gain food tokens. Various decks of cards that go here, like this crisis is, there's, you know, various contribution when you get a crisis, like say you need so much food, you need so many tools, you need so much, you put them face down here, and waste any card you use during the game other than to contribute. When you use it, it goes here. Once you get so many, it starts eating away your morale. You can clean it out. There's like objectives, like say each turn you have to do a crisis, each turn you have to do a crisis. Now you have the decks of cards. You have the crossroad cards, which that's the thing that most people find most interesting about this game is the crisis cards, or not the crossroad cards, because basically what it is when you go, the person to your left, grabs one of these, they read it. If what happens on the card, the trigger on the card happens, they read out the card and you get like so many choices to choose from. Like you can choose, some of them are, you know, this one will help you or this one will help you. This one will help you now, but not so much later. This one won't help you so much now, but could really help you later on. And then some of them are just, you know, which do you want to choose now, bad or worse? And do you want to choose bad now and hope it doesn't get worse later? Or do you want to choose something that's worse off now but won't hurt you as much later on? It's a really interesting concept. You have the... these are all crosswords, yes. And there are some crossword ones that are really mature, that are matured seam, so I think they're separated automatically. You get, these are the overall goals. It will tell you how to set it up, what your victory conditions are, and how long you have. And like I say, something long, short, medium, whatever. These are this side is the easier side to do. And the ones with an exclamation mark are more difficult. So if you're just starting out, definitely start out with this side. These are your secret objectives. Like they'll say things like select medicine, or hoard medicine, you need like X amount of medicine, or hoard tools, I think X amount of tools, or could be have everyone of your group, because you're going to have more than one character. You're going to usually have about three or four characters. Could be have all your characters armed with guns and exile the traitor, if there is one. And then there's ones to say on the bottom, say betrayal. That means you're a traitor, you're an enemy of the cause. You want to do things like get the morale down to zero so everyone else loses, or, you know, kill everyone off, have everyone else killed off, or just things like that. They're the ones that, if you have these, that means you you're actually working against everyone else. Now, then you got the exile goals. If you can get exiled, like I say, if once a turn, people go, he seems pretty suspicious. I say we kick him out because he's probably the traitor. And if majority votes to kick out the person, they are exiled, and then they get these mission cards. And like I say, they have if you're falsely exiled, then you have to do something. If you were the prayer, you have to do something else. I just can't. Basically, when you're exiled, you can't go back to the compound. You keep going to these locations, but you can't go back to the main place. You have your characters. So you have various different characters. You have a ninja, and there is Santa Claus. They have their influence number up in the corner. That basically determines who goes first and who dies first. Because if, like say, two people are on location and zombies come in, and there's one more zombie than there are spaces for it, the person with the lowest influence dies first and goes from there. The one by the burst is the combat, and the one by the magnifying glass is your search. So what you're going to do at start of round, everyone rolls X amount of dice equal to how many characters they control plus one. So you take those and you use those numbers. So if you have like a three combat, if you roll like two threes and one, you can use the threes to combat zombies. But if you combat zombies, there's a chance they can kill you back. And everyone has a power on the bottom. So basically you get your characters, you find your standees. This is my cat kit. Yes, these are the crisis cards. Overpopulation. You need food equal to the number of non-exiled players. They'll say if you fail, kill two non-exiled survivors with the lowest influence. And optional. If you succeed, there's an optional rule on this one. Like add two additional food cards to gain one morale for Prince in the Crisis. So what it is, you'll get X crisis. Then on everyone's turn, they can throw cards here face down. Now, if you're if you're not a trader, you're going to want to, like say this, you're going to want to throw only cards, the items that have, that are food here. At the end, you'll take all the cards that were put here, because everyone on a round, everyone puts in, because there's a new crisis every round. So everyone puts in. If there's enough food to cover this, then we pass. Unless someone put in something that wasn't food. If they put, like, say, if they put a tool or something, like, in this case, we need food, and they put a tool in. The tool would subtract one of the food that we needed. So, like, say, if we had, like, say, we needed four food. If there was five cards here, four of them were food, and one of them was a tool, you, one of the tools take away one of the foods, which means we only have three, which means we failed, which means the two lowest influence characters die. Generally, you only do that if you're the trader. And you got to be careful, because sometimes, like that, you can't put items in there. So, like, say, if you're the only one putting something in there, and you're putting non-food in there when you need food, or non-tools when you need tools, or what have you, then it's kind of obvious you're a trader. Unless you can play it off like, oh, I don't know, I've never played this before, I don't know what I'm doing. Which I actually had someone do that once. They actually... He had me fooled, because I was sure either he was either someone else was a traitor, or he was just messing up, and he turned out to actually be the traitor. Now these are the cards that go on the location, and there's some starter cards. So like I say, it will say, give you the name of what it is, give you what it does, and it will say where it goes. Like this case, the library, someone, like say this. So it will tell you what deck to put it in. So you have the library here. Then you have the grocery store. You have the gas station. Oh, going back to the locations. Up here, it will give you symbols. This is the type of items you can find in this location. So if you need, like, if you need guns, and you were, if you needed guns, you would not go to the grocery store, because grocery store does not have weapons. The grocery store does not supply weapons. And I believe these two packs are more items. So like I say, there's, you know, for each location you get items, and then you have the starter item. Some of these are the starter items. You get X amount of starter items at the beginning of the game. Because the rest of these are all... These are all for location. These are the starter items. So you'll shuffle these up and... randomly give out X amounts, and the rest will be put back into the box unlooked at. Like I say, you get... It will have a picture of what the item itself is. A name. It will have the icon of what it actually is, and then what you do if you use it other than for the crisis. Like this is a waste pile. Add one food token to the food supply. So basically, you use this. If you use this not for, if you don't use this to contribute here, you can use this to take one of those food tokens, put it into the supply, but this then goes into the waste. Now the reason you want to do that, because like say, you have to, not only do you have to contribute to the crisis, but you also have to have feed your survivors each time, each round. There's different things, like there's medicine. And what that does is, so the symbol right down, there's a pill of medicine. What that does is, you heal any type of wound. Like I say, you can heal, especially good if you have frostbite. You'd want to use that to get rid of the frostbite, because frostbite keeps causing wounds each turn. And it can only take three wounds before a character dies. So you use that, you get rid of one of the wound tokens. Now, if you have got frost, when I got frostbite, next turn you get damage rather than frostbite, so you only have one frostbite. So if you can get rid of that frostbite, you won't get any more damage from the frostbite until you get more frostbite. Then there, like I say, so you get a random amount of these. Basically, you have to go through and X amount of turns, accomplish whatever the secret, whatever the main goal is. You have to keep taking care of crises. Sometimes you can let it go and you might still survive. However, best not to ignore the crisis. But you also have to keep your colony fed, and you have to keep an eye out for a traitor, because there might be someone working against you, which means if they they're trying to sap bring the whole thing down to win. And you have to accomplish your own secret goal to win. So like I say, you could be a non-traitor. Your thing could be everyone has to win, or the main goal has to be accomplished, and you have to do something else. So it's possible to do everything right, actually get to the end and have the colon survive and still lose, which is a little frustrating, but it's like I say, it's not a it's an interesting sort of it's an interesting sort of game. It can be very frustrating because you're thinking, okay, is he doing this because he has a secret goal but still working with us? Is he the traitor? Should I exile him? If we exile him, then he's not really working towards the greater good. He's got another quest that he another thing to do that he needs to win, even if he's not the traitor. If I get rid of too many people, then there's not enough people working towards the end goal. Of course, if you're a traitor, if you can exile enough people so that people can't work towards the end goal, then it can help you win. So there's a lot going on in this game, but it is fun. It is a really good game. I believe that's all I have to say about this for now. Like I say, I'm gonna put the link for Online Working Cafe and the card and board monthly subscription in the link, and definitely check it out. They do an awesome job of picking out games. Because honestly, as much as I like this game, I probably wasn't going to buy it for myself because I find hidden trader games stressful, so I don't buy them. But if someone goes, "Hey, do you want to play this?" or "Hey, do you want to play Dead of Winter?" or "Hey, do you want to play Resistance?" or "Hey, do you want to play Battlestar Galactica?" I'm like, "Yeah, sure, great," but I'm not gonna go and buy them myself. I think that's all I have to say for now. Thank you for watching. This has been Cards and Boards. Oh, if you like what you see, please comment, subscribe, and like. The more reviews, the better. The more subscribers, great, because then go, "Hey, look, they got a new video out. Let's see what they got going on this time." So please like, watch, subscribe. See how cute my cat is, even though she's on the table like she's not supposed to be. That's it. Thank you for watching. It's been Cards and Boards. Have a good evening.